Jesus undo? Now, what would Jesus do? What would he undo? So far, we have looked at the fact that Jesus would undo indifference. In Revelation, writing to the church, he said, I know your works. He says, you're not hot, you're not cold, you're lukewarm. And he says, that makes me sick. Indifference. What would Jesus do? He would do indifference. Last week, we looked at the fact that Jesus would undo hollow worship. And if you were here, you heard my disappointment on an Easter that I remembered that Easter bunny that I thought was so attractive was hollow. It was empty, and what a disappointment. And you know something? Sometimes that's what happens with us. Our worship, our singing, our life, sometimes it's just hollow. And we talked about the fact that worship is a matter of the heart, not a style of music. Worship is a matter of the heart, not a style of music. So what would Jesus undo? This morning we're going to look at a behavior, an attitude that Jesus hated with all of his heart. You said Jesus hated? Yep. He hated it with all of his heart. Here it is. What is it? Hypocrisy. Now, I don't want anyone to break eye contact with me when I ask this question. Okay. How many of you know a hypocrite? Don't you dare look at the person beside you. You did. You did. You would be amazed what I see from up here. I was going to say, are you sitting beside one? But I'm not going to say that. One of the definitions that I heard of a hypocrite is a hypocrite is someone who's just not themselves on Sunday. Get that? I'll repeat it for those of you who are still thinking about football or whatever. A hypocrite is someone who's just not themselves on Sunday. Number one complaint from non-Christians has to do with that. Hypocrites. I don't go to church because someone in the church hurt me. They lied to me. I've got a business and I thought I could trust Christians and they just stuck it to me. I looked up to a Christian and they let me down. They deceived me. Sad to say, there are some who have distanced themselves from church because they've actually been abused and misused and molested by someone in the church. I want you to look at this quote from Brené Manning. It says this: the single greatest cause for atheism in the world today is Christians. Wow. The single greatest cause of atheism in the world today is Christians who acknowledge Jesus with their lips, then walk out the door and deny him with their lifestyles. This is what an unbelieving world simply finds unbelievable. That's powerful. Now, let me just remind you, this series of messages is not an accusation towards anyone. It is a call for evaluation. Okay? Not an accusation, but a call for evaluation. And that's our focus this morning. Let me first of all define what a hypocrite is not. Okay, boys, girls, adapt your message, you're helping out. What a hypocrite is not. need to have bad thoughts, but I do. I wish I didn't lie, but I did. Hypocrisy is the gap between what we show and who we are. Now, we could all pretty well describe a hypocrite, but we're just going to look at it together this morning. Again, I'll just leave it at that. Hypocrisy needs to filter what we say is how we live. What we say is how we live. It's the difference between the public persona and private character. For example, not a real good example, but for an example, my wife's not here. So, you go in the bathroom and you take care of bathroom stuff, and no one else is in the bathroom, and you go, I'm going to wash my hands. And you don't. You know you should, but you don't. Okay? Just a simple thing. Nobody will know. Right? It's a matter of the heart. Okay? Now, again, last week we were talking about the scribes and Pharisees and washing their hands and how that was all for a show. But the point is, it's the difference between what we, our public persona, and private character. The original word for hypocrite comes from one who is an actor, one who plays the part, one who hides behind a mask. Now, I have a mask. It is one of those red masks. I mean, it's just, I started to bring it this morning. I thought, no, some of you will head for the door, okay? But that's what a hypocrite is. The original word was one who hides behind a mask. They appear, but they're not that on the inside. Titus chapter 1, verse 16 describes it this way. They claim to know God, but by their actions, they deny Him. They are great people, wonderful citizens. Yes? Is that what Scripture says? No, what does it say? I mean, it's pretty in your face. They are detestable, disobedient, and unfit for doing anything good. Wow. Giving to be seen, fasting to impress, praying to be heard, criticizing others, but doing the same thing. Wearing the mask. Jesus never spoke more harshly about anything than the hypocrites. So if Jesus speaks harshly to something, I think that would be something that Jesus would undo. Let's look at Matthew 20:23. Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites! Now, these were the religious leaders of the day. These were the men who were esteemed by others because of all that they did. They wore the right clothes. They washed their hands ceremoniously. They did everything that was tradition that said, if you do this, you're a good person. Jesus says this, you're like whitewashed tombs, which look beautiful on the outside, but on the inside are full of dead men's bones and everything unclean. Now, how would you like someone get in your face and say, I'm not going to make eye contact with anyone on that. That's pretty straight up, isn't it? And we're gonna, as we unpack this morning, you'll see why Jesus hated hypocrisy. Verse 28, in the same way, on the outside you appear to people as righteous, but on the inside you are full of hypocrisy and wickedness. We look at the outside, it looks good. Whitewashed tombs. Looking good. But on the inside, dead men's bones. Full of hypocrisy, wearing the mask, but the mask hiding the heart. Hiding the anger, hiding the bitterness, hiding the hurt, hiding the envy, hiding the pride. And we could go on and on. But wearing the mask. They want the illusion of public virtue, but hiding private sins. Remember, not an accusation, but a call for evaluation. Jesus wasn't calling out their sin. What Jesus was calling out was their show. Jesus was calling out their mask. That's what he was calling out. He didn't say, do this or do that. What he was calling them to do was live like they said they lived. In our head, we get it. Jesus knows everything about me. But do we live that way in private? He knows. He knows. It is so easy to put on the mask that appears to be all good. But as we said in the beginning, the hypocrite is someone who's just not themselves on Sunday. Jesus has zero tolerance for hypocrisy. But he has absolutely unlimited grace for a sinner in need of forgiveness. You see, what he was calling out with the Pharisees is you're saying something, but you're living something else. You've got the mask on. If you would repent of your sin, God would forgive you. But you have worn the mask so long that you were out of pride, fearful of taking it off. Jesus has zero tolerance for hypocrisy, but unlimited grace for a sinner in need of forgiveness. And this is not on the screen, but in John chapter 8, I want to read to you an event that took place. As we're thinking about this, that Jesus has zero tolerance for hypocrisy, but unlimited grace for sinners in need of forgiveness. John chapter 8. But Jesus went to the Mount of Olives at dawn. He appeared again in the temple courts with all the people gathered around him, and he sat down to teach them. So very early on, Jesus sits down and he begins to teach. Verse 2. the teachers of the law and the Pharisees brought in a woman caught in adultery. They made her stand before the group and said to Jesus, "Teacher, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. In the law, Moses commands us to stone such a woman. Now, what do you say?" They were using this question as a trap in order to have a basis for accusing him. Now, there's several strange things happening in this situation. Number one, the scribes and Pharisees were looking for something to accuse Jesus with. Okay. So it says that they brought before him a woman who was not thought of as an adulterer, but was caught in the act of adultery. You can imagine the shame on her face as these self-righteous teachers and scribes pulled her in unceremoniously before Jesus and before the people. The shame. There's something between the lines that we don't automatically think about. How many people does it take to commit adultery? Just one, right? No. It takes two, okay? That doesn't come as a surprise to anyone, I hope. But here these teachers of the law, these Pharisees, they say, here is the woman. That in itself is hypocrisy. Where's the man? We don't know. We can speculate. It may have been one of their sons. It may have been an official in the city. It may have been a common, ordinary person. That who the other person was doesn't matter. What matters is these self-righteous hypocrites had no grace, had no forgiveness. What you see here is a reflection of their heart. What you see here is a group of individuals who are wearing the mask. And when we're wearing the mask, when there is hypocrisy, we are always looking for the worst in other people. The hypocrite is always looking for the worst in someone else and has no problem bringing it before people. Did you know about that non-cook? Can you? That's what they were doing. They were hiding behind this accusation. Notice Jesus' response. Jesus bent down and started to write on the ground with his finger. When they kept on questioning him, he straightened up and said to them, "If any one of you is without sin, let him throw the first stone." And again he stooped down and wrote on the ground. Now we are not told, and probably wisely so, what Jesus wrote on the ground. We can only speculate. I speculate because of how Jesus felt towards hypocrisy that he may have, the first time when he bent down in the ground, he may have started writing the names of the individual accusers, beginning with the oldest to the youngest. He may have done that. And then he says, when which of you is without sin, let him throw the first stone. And he stooped down and started writing again. I want to believe that when he stooped down the second time, he began writing out the sins of every one of those individuals, beginning with the oldest to the youngest. Those scribes and Pharisees may have started looking at each other. And now the shame and the guilt is being turned on them. Jesus is calling them out. He's calling them out. At this, those who heard began to go away one at a time. The older first, until Jesus was left with the woman standing there. Jesus straightened up and asked her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" Wow. What if Jesus showed up in churches across America today? And he began listening to the talk before service. And as the service began and worship happened, that wasn't reflecting a condition of the heart, but it was just doing the thing, that Jesus stepped forward. And he began writing names on a whiteboard. Okay? It's okay. Jesus knows my name. But then, under the names, he began writing the secret sins of individuals. Bitterness, pride, arrogance, envy. It just goes on and on. I wonder how quickly a lot of churches would empty out. Think about it. Not an accusation, but a call for evaluation. A call to allow God's Spirit to open the windows of our heart and show us anything we're hiding behind that is a mask of hypocrisy that doesn't measure up to what we appear to be. Pastor, on this is hard stuff. It's what Jesus would have to do. Yeah. If we focused on what would Jesus do, that would almost give us an open door to be hypocrites from the outside. We need to look on the inside. And Jesus says to this woman, "Where are your accusers?" By now, she's probably still hanging her head. Maybe have glanced up, expecting at any moment for the stoning to take place. But when she glanced up, all of her accusers were gone. You see, Jesus has zero tolerance for hypocrisy. And he's calling it out. But notice the last verse. "No one, sir," she said. "Neither do I condemn you," Jesus declared. "Go now unlimited grace for sinners in need of forgiveness. I'm convinced that our churches, that our society would be radically altered if we as God's people understood this. How many times have there been individuals in your life, people that you work with, family members, someone in your neighborhood, someone you came in contact with, and said, I can't believe that. They're such a vile, wicked sinner. And it comes across. It comes across. We may not say the words, but our attitude is, I am far better than you. Without taking a looking glass and doing some self-evaluation. I wonder what kind of effect it would have on our nation if God's people stopped pretending to be something we're really not. I don't think this is a place for me to ask for an amen. That old me is probably more appropriate. This community that we feel called to reach is looking for men and women and boys and girls who are real. No masks! No masks. You say, Pastor Ron, what do I do? If we confess our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. What is it in your life? Or is there anything in your life that you would be ashamed of if your pastor knew? Don't would you? Don't. Please don't say anything. Is there anything in your life that you would be ashamed if your pastor knew about? And you know, sometimes I'm saying this out of love. I can care less. Let's take off the mask and let's get down to the reality. It really doesn't matter if there's something in your life that you would be ashamed that if I knew. But God knows. And if we're pretending to be something that we're not, it's hypocrisy. And Jesus is calling it out. You appear to be something that you're not. And the world needs to see Christ in us. Not hypocrisy. Because sooner or later, someone is going to find out the thing you don't want them to find out about you. And they're going to say, the single greatest cause for atheism, I'll say unbelief, in the world today is Christians who acknowledge Jesus with their lips, then walk out the door and deny him with their lifestyle. This is what the unbelieving world simply finds unbelievable. Say, Pastor, if I knew this was the subject of the message this morning, I'd slip in. And if that's the case, I'm going to say this with a smile. You old hypocrite. With a smile, not an accusation, but a call for an evacuation. With the scribes and Pharisees. The Pharisees, I mean, one of the definitions of the Pharisee is, fair, I see myself. I see myself as better than everyone else. And here's the result of it. Here's the result of it. Jesus calls them out. But there's good news. He says, I'm waiting. Hope for the hypocrite. Here it is. Matthew 23:25-26. Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites! You are clean. You clean the outside of the cup and dish, but inside are full of greed and self-indulgence. Blind Pharisees, first clean the inside of the cup and dish, and then the outside will also be clean. That's the hope, folks. Jesus knows us. There is nothing hidden from Him. You can hide from me, you can hide from your neighbors, you can hide from your husband or your wife, but He knows. And He says, stop trying to clean the outside up until you clean the inside out. Stop trying to clean the outside up until you have cleared the inside. Am I speaking truth?
Amen.
Self-examination, and you've heard me say this multiple times, self-examination is very painful. But the unexamined life is not a life worth having. By society's standards, the scribes, Pharisees, teachers of the law were the esteemed. They had all the appearance outwardly that they were good, godly men. But Jesus says, I know your heart. I know what no one else knows. And as a matter of fact, if you want me to write your sins down for you, I can do that. Far better to be an honest sinner than a lying hypocrite. Far better to be an honest sinner than a lying hypocrite. Someone who's just not themselves. Proverbs 28:13. He who conceals his sins does not prosper. But whoever confesses and renounces them finds mercy. Attempt to conceal our sins by putting a mask on, you will not prosper spiritually. You'll live life wondering, why can't I be blessed the way this other Christian is blessed? I'm just as good as them. As a matter of fact, I'm even better than them. I've got more things. I've got a better job. I have a better reputation than you. Why can't I be? That in itself betrays what's on the inside. Remember when two people went in to the temple to pray, and the Pharisees prayed, and he said, he looked at this outcast. He said, God, I thank you that I am not like this poor sinner. Oh, God, I thank you that I am not like him. And when this man prayed, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. A call for evaluation, not accusation. We will not reach this community if we're wearing masks. No one may know, but God knows. And God says, listen, you will not be blessed if you're concealing your sin, but whoever confesses and renounces it finds mercy. Jesus has zero tolerance for hypocrisy. But he has unlimited grace for a sinner in need of forgiveness. And I just want to tell you something. That's me. That's me. That's your pastor. That's the one you think has got it all together, doesn't have any problems. Wrong. I am a sinner. In need of grace and forgiveness. And if you're thinking, boy, I'm not like my pastor, with a smile, I would say, you old hypocrite, you middle-aged hypocrite, you young hypocrite. Do we just need to pray and go home? There are probably people in your sphere of life and influence similar to that woman caught in the act of adultery. How do you respond? How do you respond? Any love? They don't need your condemnation. They don't need us looking down our noses at them and saying, God, thank you, and I'm not like that sinner. We are all broken. We are all broken in need of grace and mercy. And if you are so, if someone you know is so above that, they fit the criteria of a hypocrite. Jesus has zero tolerance for hypocrisy, but unlimited grace for a sinner in need of forgiveness. Open the eyes of my heart. Open the eyes of my heart. If you are a child of God and you have accepted Christ as your Savior, it was the condemnation of your sin that brought you to see the need of the Savior, and you accepted him. But we still have that struggle of the flesh that needs to be confronted with truth and not hidden behind a mask. know Jesus as your Lord and Savior. If you don't, I have fabulous news for you. Jesus knows everything there is to know about you and loves you enough to give you new life. Just as he did for that woman taken in the sin of adultery, he forgave her. And then said, now listen, I forgive you. Go out and be changed. She couldn't do that on her own. The guilt and shame was too great. But when she accepted God's forgiveness, Jesus' forgiveness, she left that arena radically different. Jesus didn't call for a cleaning up of the outside. He called for a change on the inside. And if you've never made that decision this morning, he is standing with open arms saying, I love you enough that I want to give you a life like you've never experienced before. If you've never made that decision, a simple prayer, a prayer of faith, God, today I understand. Today, I choose to believe that Jesus lived, died, and rose again. And today, I receive him as my Savior. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. If you prayed that prayer, I'd encourage you, before you leave here, let me go. For those of us who are in Christ, what would Jesus undo? Something that he absolutely hated, and that's hypocrisy. Would you, in the quietness of this moment, open your heart, and if there is anything there that needs to be confessed, give it to him. Spirit has the ability of nailing us where we are. Because he who conceals his sin does not prosper, but whoever confesses and renounces them finds mercy. Father, Jesus was in this world. He didn't come to make everyone feel good. He came to be the Savior of the world. And the only way that he could be the Savior of the world is when he would confront sin, our sin. God, I just pray that this morning, those of us who know, would remove any masks that need to be removed, so we can live in the abundance of the life that's ours from Christ. And if there's someone here this morning that's been hiding behind Christians that haven't been Christians, that have hurt them, betrayed them, God, I pray that they move beyond that and see that Jesus died for them. I ask it all in Jesus, in his name. Let's stand and sing. If God spoke to you this morning, you just want to come and pray, you want us to pray with you, let's just respond to Jesus this morning, okay? If there are masks that need to be dropped, drop them.
Thank you.
For some of you, he would have you to leave here with guilt and condemnation. Jesus wants you to leave here with freedom. With freedom. Not guilt and condemnation, but joy and freedom. Amen?
Amen.
So if you're leaving here with guilt and condemnation, it ain't from Jesus. Unless you live in freedom of who you are. Would you be seated for just a minute? A couple of announcements. Really, I told you there's some exciting things happening I need to make you aware of. Some of you are saying, well, where's Rodetta? Is she out again? Yep, she is. She's with 22 pastor's wives from 6 different states and 7 different denominations. And they are ministering in a phenomenal way. So she's exhausted, okay, in a good way. So keep that in mind. Trunk or treat. We have been invited to participate with Mock Bird. So we need you to sign up if you're willing to sign your car up, okay, to serve as a trunk, okay. We'll start collecting candy next week, so the bins will be out there. So all month we'll be able to bring in candy so that October the 31st, thank you very much, we will participate on this with the city with Trunk or Treat. That following Saturday is Mont Verde Day. Okay. You say, well, how in the world did that happen? There was some scheduling stuff and everything. It's not up to us to figure out why that happened. What's up to us is to figure out how we can minister. Okay? So, Don Hyatt, stand up.
Yes, sir.
I'm just one of the ugliest men in the church. You said
wrong.
Thankfully, nobody said amen. So it's just you and I. That's for me. Don is coordinating Mont Verde Day. We need to have a meeting for those of you that will help on Mont Verde Day right after service, okay? But after you finish the meeting, before you leave, go across the way into the other building and see the radical transformation of our nursery and preschool. How many of you have already been over
there? Amen.
Oh, my heart be still.
Yes.
Okay. Holiday and Robert, you all have done a phenomenal job. A lot of construction, a lot of work. Some of them said, when is it ever going to be done? It's closer and it's moving this way. Children's room is next, okay? And that means first grade through sixth grade are going to have their place, okay, for children's room. Yes, Tom.
You would not believe the look on Charlotte's face as she walked in. I have pictures and I'm getting sandy. Okay. But I mean, this child was like, I went to several different places without even mom and daddy prompting. That's a great place.
See, that's what we want to communicate. When visitors are coming, they're going to walk in that area with their children, nursery, preschool, elementary kids, and they're going to say, this place cares about my kids. So I need to be here. Amen? So please, after the meeting, don't you go before the Mont Verde meeting, okay, if you're going to be here for that, go across the way and take a look at that. If you're not amazed, if you're not blessed, then your blesser's just broken. And come back and we'll have a prayer for your blesser. Let's see. Any other announcements? Oh, Becky, yes, ma'am. After the Mont Verde meeting, we need you to sign up to be greeters. We need people who can do this.
Oh my God.
You don't really have to say anything. Just smile, okay? So we need those people, okay? Embrace Church is the perfect place for imperfect people.
Amen.
All right. Thank you for being here. Let's stand. Chris, would you dismiss us in prayer, please?
So let me ask you.
you a question this morning, church. Does God want what's best for you?
Yes.
Yeah. And the scripture says, this is the day the Lord has made. You know what that makes today? Your best day. Let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we have heard your word. Help us, Father, help us to not just be hearers, but be doers. Father, may we lay aside the weight and sin and every sin which so easily entangles. And Father, may we leave here and live this best day you've given us for your glory. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
All right, my birthday. My birthday is the 1st and 2nd. We will be doing small water bottles as we did last year. We will be doing cookies as we did last year. We're going to be doing balloons. Mike and Tanya are setting that up now. Face painting.